Good evening, friends. I am Ritesh Panpalia, President, Vidarbha Management Association, welcome you all to this program. In VMA, we have a tradition of charging rupees 100 fine whenever a phone rings. I request all of you to please keep your mobile in a silent or switch off mode. Thank you, friends. VMA is committed to impart knowledge through Sunday sessions, workshops, seminars, outbound programs to its members. To spread the knowledge of management to public at large, VMA successfully invited personalities of highest repute to Nagpur in the past. In continuing with this effort, VMA has organized this session on excellence in leadership. And it is also a coincidence that it is the 150th anniversary of Swami Vivekananda, the great leader himself. Friends, we are going through a very challenging and turbulent phase. In such challenging time, the role of leader becomes more important. We all present here are leader in one way or the other. Some may be leading their organization, some may be the head of the respective department, or our family look up to you as a leader. Now, as a leader, how do I achieve excellence? This million-dollar question will be answered today. This question can only be answered by a person who has been a leader all his life, who has led from the front, motivated his men, and stood tall all this year. An IPS officer of 1968 batch, called as the greatest spy master of India by Hindustan Times and the best intelligence officer India has ever seen. Friend, it is a moment of utmost pride and pleasure to have Shri Ajitji Doval with us this evening. Whenever India was in a situation of crisis, whether it was a Mizoram conflict or a Punjab issue or a Kashmir issue, he was always there to serve India. He was the man who was inside the Harminder Singh Sahib during Operation Black Thunder. He was also the chief negotiator during IC-814 hijack. He headed the Intelligence Bureau Operation Wing for over a decade, a recipient of Kirti Chakra, one of the highest gallantry award, and he was the youngest police officer to be awarded prestigious police medal. He retired as the director of Intelligence Bureau. Presently, he is a director of Vivekananda International Foundation. Ladies and gentlemen, put your hand together for Shri Ajitji Doval. I request our executive member Sachin Jagirdar to escort Doval ji to the dais. Thanks, Sachin. Now I request Secretary Nagpur branch of Chartered Accountant Mrs. Kirti Agrawal to welcome our speaker by offering floral bouquet. Madam. Sir, the floor is all yours, sir.
I just had the occasion of saying two very absorbing snippets on the screen. It's indeed a matter of great honor and pleasure for me to be in this function organized by the Vivekananda, Vidarbha Management Association and Vivekananda Kendra, Nagpur. I must compliment the way that they have been organizing their functions, the way that they have been trying to build a spirit decor. They have been trying to build a sense of unity and commonly trying to find the solutions to the problems. My most grateful thanks to Shri Ritesh Panpaliaji, President of the VMA, Shri Anand Bagdiaji and all others whom I had the pleasure of meeting during the day that I was here. I have been asked to speak on excellence in management or excellence in leadership. Well, friends, this word leadership has different connotations and different meanings. And we are living in this age of corporate world where probably it has assumed an entirely new definition. In a way, all our life, you and me, consciously or unconsciously, we are either leading or we are being led. Even a four-year-old child you in the house at times leads you, is running and you are chasing him, or he's doing something naughty and you are trying to prevent him. In the society, in the workplace, in the social groups, in the family, we are constantly interacting with the people. And leadership is all about interactions. In modern parlance, we call it transactional analysis. We try to analyze why you behave the way that you behave. Why do I behave the way that I behave? Just wonder, is it something always the very rational, logical, well-calculated decision that you take and thereafter you act? Or is it impetuous, spontaneous? Or is it an emotional outburst? Or is it that there are influences working on you that you are not aware of? You read, you see the TV, you read the newspapers. Probably the answer lies that it's a combination of all. But the fact remains, that is, we are constantly transacting with the rest of the world. Each one of you with 7.2 billion people of the world who are living in this world, we have got some sort of a transactional equation with them. There is a need to explore that amongst many things that influence your thinking, your behavior, your action, is there also an element that you are being led? You are being made to behave because some force, either directly or indirectly, is controlling you. Maybe that it is your boss who is controlling you. Or maybe it is your family that is controlling you, or your wife which is controlling you. But you are being led. You don't admit it, or you are not even aware of it. Now, as I said, this leading is of various varieties and various types. And that is why there are a lot of confusion that gets created. There is a leadership that arises out of authority. What we call as a positional leadership. You are an army chief. You have got an army of 11 lakh under you. You are the leader of the Indian army. By virtue of your position, you make one division to move from one sector to another, or you make orders, or you take the decisions, or you are the prime minister, or you are a CEO of your company, or you are a head of your organization. Each one of you sitting in this room are successful people. You are successful because you lead. Whether consciously or not, but you lead. In turn, you are also being led. And you have, while you have got plenty of successes, you have achieved many things, you still have the longing for having not achieved many things that you wanted to achieve. While there is a success, there is also a feeling of inadequacy. You know, if leadership is all about change, so you want to change. Leader only changes. There is something that exists. He wants to change what exists into something what he thinks is more desirable. And let me tell you one thing. This change is not only a function of leadership. There can be individuals who can be great men on their own, work in isolation, sit in a cave and pray or meditate for the welfare of the world or humanity or mankind. Probably they are also contributing, but they are not leaders. They may be great saints. They may be great scientists. They may be great solo performers. But leadership is when you change through the people. When you change through the medium, through the instrumentality of the people that you come in contact with. The people that you control, the people who listen to you, the people on whom you wield influence. And that is why I said there is one type of leadership, that is positional leadership. This is another one. And since these days we talk in corporate this thing and other, it is more about positional leadership. And the rules of engagement, the rules of game, the rules of the principles which go on the positional leadership are slightly different from the rules of other type of leadership. Now there's an intellectual leadership. Some people, some intellectual comes with an idea. Mark sitting in the London library is one of the rooms and working over there for a very long years, writes Das Kapita. Provides an intellectual leadership to people for 100 years. Leads to various revolutions, various changes in areas that he had never seen and visited. Makes communism as one of the distinct, he or Angels and others. They provided, you know, in 70s, we had people like, say, Kanu Sanyal and Majumdar and Charu Majumdar and others. The bright young boys from IITs, from universities and others, they got intellectually infatuated with an idea of what their version of an equitable society or the ultimate justice was. And they got converted into a thinking. Why did they think the way? Because they were led to think that way. Who led them to think that way? Some intellectual made them to think that way. You also get influenced. Sometimes you read the books. And you read Shavalesha's book, or you read some other this thing, or some other great corporate giant, or those things, and you find that some of their personal experiences, some of the good practices used by them, you somehow find, well, they do fit in your style of thinking as well. And in that process, they have led you. Now, this is slightly a higher degree of leadership than the positional leadership, which we may call as the intellectual leadership. Intellectual leaderships are able to make you do a lot of things, change considerably. But there is still a higher degree of leadership. Some of them are not very good, but they are leaders nevertheless. That is emotional leadership. People control your emotions. Osama bin Laden, whatever his bad points may be, not that I am here to defend him. But he was able to inspire so many youth in 57 countries of the world where there were Islamic regimes and many other parts of the world where they were living either in the minority or in smaller numbers. And recruit people from all over the world to take on a fight which is inhuman, to take on a fight which was against the interest of the very religion that he stood for, and was sure and was destined to die the death of a defeat. But he was emotionally able to charge people with the slogan of jihad. There was no reasoning. It was not an intellectual leadership. But it was an emotional leadership. And you find that intellectual leadership gets dwarfed in front of the emotional leadership, at least for short times. Just as positional leadership gets dwarfed before the intellectual leadership. You know, when I was sitting here, I read a very wonderful quote here. Somebody had written it. I must say, I think, the Think, Partnering Wealth Creation. Anyone can sell you a solution. If you look at the list, I think it is written here. That will get you from A to B, but unfortunately, B isn't always where you want it to be. These emotional leaders take you to a point B, but then point B is not the solution of the life. That is not where you want it to be. You change. They do change you. They create a jihadi. But that does not solve either the problem of the world or the problem of Islam or promotes peace or makes this world more livable. It doesn't. Or even helps Islam. But then it is an emotional leadership.
So there is still a higher degree of leadership. And that is where, you know, this question is often asked. Leaders are born or made. And I often say, well, they are both made and sometimes they are born. It depends upon what type of leadership we are talking about. Positional leaders are always made. They cannot get born. If you are a leader of, you have got to be professional, you have got to have skills, you have to have the knowledge, you have got to have the vision. And there are many common qualities which are required everywhere. But you can't be a positional leader just because you are born like that. You can't born as a great surgeon and be the Surgeon General of United Kingdom. You have got to get those skills. You become the great leader amongst the surgical community because you have done years and years of practice, patience, hard work, tapasya, tyag, everything. Intellectual leadership also can be cultivated. You can study, you can research, you can this thing, and then you can make changes. Emotional leadership also is cultivable. We see the specter of it at times during the communal rites, how the emotions are created. But there's one type of leadership about which I think that it cannot be developed by a man within one birth. That is what Swamiji said. And that is a spiritual leadership. A leadership at spiritual level. A leadership which is the most superior quality of leadership. A leadership when men are changed and this thing, which goes and remains with them for births and this thing together. Let me see if I've got that quote which he had this thing. And Swamiji said that, I am persuaded, and I'm quoting him, that a leader is not made in one life. He has to be born for it. Difficulty is not in organization and making plans. The test, the real test of a leader lies in holding different people together along the line of their common sympathies, and this can only be done unconsciously, never by trying. Now, the point I'm trying to say is this, that don't mistake the spiritual leadership as the only quality of leadership. But it's good to know. That is, if you develop your own spiritual strength and sinews, nothing helps you more than this quality in becoming a leader. And developing this spiritual strength means a lot, and that is not the subject of my discussion today. It means a lot about the values, a lot about your selfishness, a lot about the cause. But let me tell you one thing more, that often these things do not come in compartments. There is a mix. There is a mix of a positional leadership, an intellectual leadership, an emotional leadership, a spiritual leadership, and each one of you, each one of us, probably have got some element of it. You know, it is just like making a lot of masalas together. And sometimes there's a namak more and something, there's a mirch more or something like that. But then everything, it has got some portion of it. Now this question, which was the letter that was sent to me by the Vidarbha Management Association, said that the subject is about excellence in leadership. Now the problem of tackling this question, that the excellence in each one of these sectors is different. When I say excellence in positional leadership, then I will say that, okay, if you are an intelligence officer, how good you are professionally, how good is your trade craft, how much is your vision, how much is the courage you have got, how much is the new things, innovativeness that you have got. And if you are leading a social organization, probably entirely different skills and knowledge sets are required. So when it comes to excellence, it becomes little more compartmentalized, segmented. But then since this was the subject and I had agreed to speak, I thought I would try to find out some of the points which are common to all. And plenty of them are common. Maybe that difference of emphasis may be there, but plenty of them are common. The excellence in leadership is that bigger the idea, greater the leader. Smaller the idea. If I want to increase my profit by 5,000 rupees, it's a small vision, small idea, small effort, small quality of leadership. If I want to take over the apple, it's a big idea. If I want to make India a country which is very great and which is able to, by its strength, by its economy, by its young demography, by its natural resources, geopolitical position, is able to become a very, very important nodal country in the Asian region and is able to protect its strategic interest, is able to take care of its 1.25 billion people and is able to have in the committee of nation the respect that it deserves. It's a big idea. Now let us look at it. How the big idea makes great leaders. There are men, you know, they're slaves living in Egypt. Many of them, they follow a particular religion, they call themselves as Zionist Jews. They are slaves, they are persecuted, they are beaten, they are those things, and one man stands amongst them. And he says, let me take you to the promised land. He takes a stick in his hand and he says, okay, let me walk through the Sinai desert. Comes to the Red Sea, crosses over that and others. Big idea. It's a great example in leadership. He had nothing. No army. No physical power. He had a great personal happy life because he had been adopted by mistake by the princely family of Egypt. He was living in the palace. But he wanted to become the deliverer of his oppressed people. So he just takes and walks and through a bush then he says that he has got the light and he has got the Ten Commandments. But then he writes. Look at it. 1857 had taken place in India. East India Company was replaced by the British Crown. Entire white man had taken on himself. Hundreds of books were being written. Our own newspapers in this thing. People thought that, well, they are educated only if they can learn English. You could get the job, you could get the privileges, you could get only in case if you could eat with the hand, you are primitive. It's only that if you could use the fork and the knife that probably you knew what is the district like. Then everybody tried to transform itself into the mode of excellence, which was the English lifestyle. Will you believe? That is, an order was passed by the government that the Indian girls who could bequeath children from the white people would be given a thing of 5 rupees for their lifetime. Because they said, we want to create, there's an order. Initially it was the British, and then after 6 months they said it can be made out, the British or a non-British, because this can't be this thing. So it was replaced with a white man, because they thought that, well, even if the white man we will have, a breed of people, a section of the people in India who will think English, who will have a just, and that is how the class of Anglo-Indians came. It is through a government order. And see the misery of the people, that for her whole life, for this thing of 5 rupees, the Indian girls carried the children of the white man. Create the class of this sort of indignity was there in which this country was living. A man arises. He says it should change. How it should change? He says, I will deal with the British later. Let me first deal with my own people. Let me give them a sense of pride. Let me make them feel a sense of belonging and a sense of excellence in their own self, their history, their tradition, their culture. What a big idea. And see the environment in which such an idea takes place. He said, I will make each man, each individual, he is the treasure of my motherland. He said, man making is nation building. So he gave this thing of the slogan of man making. Each one, everyone, every child. And what is that man making? It was not only that he was thinking of making great saints and spiritual leaders or great scholars and Vedas and Upanishads. No. He wanted them to have the pride. He wanted them to have the confidence. He wanted to have them the sense of dignity. He wanted them to have the capability and the confidence that they can face the world and stand on their two legs. This is an India he wanted to make. So I was telling that what brings excellence in leadership? What makes a leader great is the size of his idea, is the size of his vision. And greater the vision, greater the leader. Now, having vision, the people who have got vision, they have got one another quality. They live in future, they think of the future. Now, Swami Vivekananda was proud of the past, but did not want to live in the past. He wanted Indians to become proud of their past, but he wanted them to work for the future. So he said, make strong bodies, go and learn martial arts, play football, freeze your gods and goddesses for 50 years, work to make an Indian community that is strong. So he lives in future. So if you have got a vision, note that. If you are always in your vision, or if you want to change, and in the process of change, you find that the traction of your mind, the trajectory of mind, is going more towards that my grandfather's glory, my good grandfather's this thing, my caste, my ancestry, this thing. Probably, you will never be able to translate a vision into the reality on the ground. Think of the future. Live in the future. Then he has got the third quality. And that differentiates him from a dreamer to a visionary. That is, he has the ability and the determination to convert his vision into action. If you do not have that determination, let me tell you, leaders are ordinary people with extraordinary determination. That determination is something that it says that, well, you know, I will, main samudra ko pee jaunga, main pahadon se lad jaunga. Matlab wo, he always feels himself so empowered. And that is what brings then excellence in this. Intensity of your vision should be so much that you should be prepared to destroy everything to achieve your goal and your objective. You know, when we say these days sometimes some just things about, yesterday I think there was a talk, and this thing, Manishankaraya's talk, okay, let Modi become a chai wala and sell the chai. What he was failing to understand that the leadership is the determination of a chai wala's son or a chai wala boy to become the prime minister of this country. That is the determination. Only those who have got that determination can change. And those who can change, they can only lead. What are the other? So I said one is the vision. And I think you and I both share this view that you can't be a great leader without a great vision, and in whichever form you are, maybe in a business, in a job, and things like, think big. Come with a new idea, see a new picture, a different picture. You know, all of you are sitting here. You ask five people to write two sentences about everybody sitting here, you find that they have looked at it in a different way, everyone. Everybody gets a picture. Somebody will say that, well, there are more men, less women. Somebody will say the more people wearing white clothes than the darker clothes. Somebody will say there are more young, more old or something. Somebody will say so many chairs were empty, so many were full. But somebody will look at it entirely differently, that these are the people who are glued to the future. We find that there is a new picture, a different picture, a picture of change. Learn to understand, learn to see that new picture. But what besides the vision for excellence in leadership? Excellent leaders believe. Not they believe in themselves. They believe in others. And they believe in the cause. He believes in himself that he has the ability to change. When Subhash Chandra Bose said in Singapore, "Tum mujhe khoon do, main tumhe azadi dunga." What was he talking? Some small contingent of Indian soldiers who have joined the INA, some of them are not even fully trained in some of this thing. The mighty British Empire, which is almost at this thing of winning the Second World War, was in alliance with the entire distinct of from United States, all the light and things like that, etc. He was challenging and he said that he was going to attack India. But he did attack. He did reach the Imphal. He was able to get a distinct of the Imphal. And when Prime Minister Attlee was told, and he came to this thing and he was staying with the Chief Justice at that time, he said, "Why did you leave India? After all, you had won the Second World War. Gandhi had almost got this thing like that. The worst was over. The Quit India movement had flopped in 1942. What was such much a tearing hurry in 47 that you said that, no, we have to go immediately?" He said it was not that. It was the spark that Bose had created among the soldiers of the Indian Army. And we had seen 1857. 2.5 million, 25 lakh Indian soldiers had returned from victorious from the Second World War. And when the incidents like this started taking place, there was this thing, revolt in the Karachi Naval Dock base, there was this thing in Jabalpur, there was this thing in Asansol, in so many places, and people joined the INA. He said, "We knew we will not be able to take this country and hold this country." It was the threat of Subhash Bose. A rising of Indian nationalism, that we knew it's a matter of time. And if we do not quit voluntarily, we will quit in a way that there will be a bloodbath. So they believe in themselves. When he says, "Tum mujhe khoon do, main tumhe azadi dunga," do you know how much of a blood he gave? It is the sole example in the annals of warfare, where two-thirds attrition took place in the Indian National Army. Two-thirds people died of their entire strength of 60,000. And still, they kept on fighting and were even tried in independent India after that. And the government never rehabilitated this thing or integrated them into the Indian Army. But anyway, that's a separate story. I'm not talking about Subhash Bose here. But I'm talking about the belief. So if you have got a belief, if you have got a dream, first is this, do you believe yourself that you can do it? If you want to make a business empire, or if you want to have a great business consultancy firm, or if you want to convert your this thing like that, do you believe in yourself, in your ability, your commitment, your courage, your sense of sacrifice to do that? If you can. Again, I would like to repeat, Leaders are ordinary people with extraordinary determination. And that determination comes because of the fact that they believe. You know, I think the history is full of some examples. Let me tell you one thing. In 1592, there's a young boy who is a vagabond. Everybody said he was a useless man, doing nothing in life. Parents fed up with him. Anyway, he started making ships. He wanted to become a mariner. He was in Spain. So he said that, well, I would like to find a new way to go to India. His name was Christopher Columbus. Everybody told him, you're a fool. How can you go this way towards west and reach India? He said, no, I'll go. I'll find the new world. So he made a ship, Santa Maria. So the king was just saying, they said that, okay, what to do? Then they said, it's like, there are a lot of condemned prisoners who had to be killed, who had to be hanged for various offenses, crimes and others. They said, sab inko de do. So bolo, ye apna jahaj lo, jao. So usne jahaj bana diya tha. So with all these convicted prisoners, they were all handcuffed and things like that, etc. They were rowing. Din guzar gaye, hafte guzar gaye, mahine guzar gaye. Kahan ke bola, kuch nahi mila. Everybody said, they all wanted to revolt against him. But he said, no, I will reach. I will reach the new world. Then almost there was the last night when he was going to be killed. There was a revolt. So he came down. He said, we will reach. But then when he came back, he thought, what happens if he doesn't reach? So he had some bottles. In that he wrote a message. I would like every one of you to remember this message. He says, if you have got a dream, if you have got a vision, try to fulfill it with your own strength, if you can. But if you can't, have people who trust you, who believe in you. That brings me to the second point of belief. That is, first they believe in themselves, but then they believe in others. They are able to make others believe in them. Swami Vivekananda in 1893 was to address a big hall like maybe some Albert Hall or something like that in London. Our preparations were made. Suddenly Swamiji said that, well, today Swami Shadananji will talk. Now people said that, do you have confidence? He said, yes, I have got confidence. I have got confidence in my entire team, all the people who are with me. I have got total confidence in them. And he spoke, and thereafter, whole army of the sannyasis came who started speaking and carrying his mission forward. Because earlier it was only lone Swami Vivekananda. Thereafter it was the entire Ramakrishna mission. And the distinct people who started carrying the message of India's spiritual greatness to the world. So that belief in others, trust begets trust. If you trust others, they start trusting you. When they trust you, then only your leadership gets legitimacy. They follow you because they trust you. They follow you because when he says, I will take you to the promised land, they know he will take him to the promised land. When people followed Subhachandra Bose, it is because those people of the Indian National Army trusted him. Ye aadmi hame azadi dilayega. Because he trusted them, they died for him. Because they died for him, India got independence. It is that Britishers understood that a revolt in the Indian army is something that they will not be able to handle. You know, when Swamiji gave the slogan, arise, awake and stop not till the goal is reached, as the panacea, as the prescription for making India, for liberating India, for making it bondage free, from extricating it from the morass in which it was placed. It showed his faith, his trust, his confidence in the people of this country. He tells them, "Your eyes and awake." He tells them, "You will get it." If he had no faith in them, and he would have said, "Are kuch hai karenge, aisa bekar hai, 5 rupaye ka koi naukri de dega, koi angrez aake isko wo kar dega, koi khareed lega, kisko dhamka dega, kisi ko dara dega." He didn't believe, he didn't have it. He said, "Okay, maybe do char aadmi aise honge, but Indians will arise. India will become great someday." He had a faith in India's destiny, and he had a faith in India's destiny because he had a faith in the people of this country. But there's a third quality. I'm sorry, today I'm slightly unwell. I think I can take a medicine also. They've got another third quality. And I tell you, you know, it's a very strange thing. This third quality was first articulated by a Chinese about 2,500 years back. His name was Lao Tzu. Now, Lao Tzu is a very great philosopher and a thinker of the Chinese. He had said one thing. This is not very relevant in the very modern context or in the context of the leadership that we are talking in the modern sense, but it is something that you should understand. And I quote Lao Tzu, he says, "Great leaders are those whose presence is not even felt. When their work is done, people say, 'We did it.'" Its meaning will not be totally understood. What was Swami Vivekananda known in his own lifetime? If you see the literature, see the comments and things like that, in his own lifetime, what was he known as? Did anybody think that, well, he was making a thinking and visualizing a great change to liberate India, to throw away the British, to create the Indians who will revolt against them? He is the one who will create people who subsequently became the great patriots and the great freedom fighters, who all owed it to Swami Vivekananda? No, they thought he was a great spiritual leader. They thought he was a great saint. They thought he was a great reformer. He was all this, but he was much more beyond that. Actually, in addition to all these things, he was a great Indian revolutionary and a patriot. He was building India for a change. He was building India for throwing away the British. He was building India for retrieving its civilizational cultural strength, proud of its heritage, and getting the place in the world as a Vishwaguru, as a spiritual leader, as a leader of values and things like that. That is the position in which he wanted India to be brought. You think a slave country can become like that? If you have got to become like that, you have to first throw away the British, not only throw away, you have to vanquish them, massacre them. I am forgetting, there is a great Sanskrit shlok, which, thank you. Manasa chintitam karyam vachaneena na prakashayet. Mantravat rakshet gopyam. And I think the last sentence is about till it is achieved, or till the objective is achieved. That is, your real objectives, your cause, that is important. Your methodology, your testing, etc., they are all less important. So, when he was having such a great cause, that is what Lao Tzu is telling, that when their work is done, people will say, "We did it." We have got the whole things of the Indian patriots, Indian freedom fighters and others, and who are getting the pension and others. You will not know how many hundreds of Indian patriots sacrificed themselves for this country, for its freedom, whose names are not even known. Who are not even remembered. They never wanted to be remembered. They never wanted to be in the limelight. But that is a very, very superior quality of leadership. That is the commitment to the cause. That is much beyond this mundane, this thing. It is something at the much higher level. But it is good to be conscious of the fact, because that gives you that spiritual strength. That gives you the You know, I said that leadership is all about change. And then I also added that leadership is changing this world, or changing your environment, or changing the people you interact with, through the instrumentality of other people, not only through your own effort. If you change your farm and work day and night, it's your individual performance. But when you make 10 other people to work for you and make a very modern farm like somebody in Israel will make or something like that, it's, you say that, well, it was a teamwork and you are a leader. It's a very, very difficult task. And you as leaders in whatever position, you would always be telling that it's a very difficult task. How do I motivate people? Even children do not get motivated the way we want them to. How do we inspire them? How do we translate our ideas and visions into their minds? Now, how do you do this? The leader, when he wants to bring about a change, he first changes himself. You know, in intelligence work, there's a very special type of training. I shouldn't be saying that, but then I can tell you because many books that I write about it. The training is this, that is, you never go and give your identity what your identity is. You take different identities. And sometimes at the same time you are working in four different places as a journalist, as a writer, as a anything else. It can be anything good, bad, something like that, depending upon what you want to be. No, we have to train people for that. If you have to send somebody to X country and in that country he has got to live and he has got to this thing, well, he should know the religion, culture, method, language, everything there. So we train them. When we train them, we find that even after a very long training, they make mistakes, which gives them way. That is, somebody will just be going and just see some people appear somewhere and then will just bow his head. Or something like that, it's an event and this thing like that, but because that is his inadvertent action. Now, do you know what they are trained, what they are told? You start first believing you are what you want to be. So, a leader must start believing strongly what he is. So, believe in your change and transform yourself. Think like a leader. Behave like a leader, talk like a leader, everywhere, every time. It is not a theater performance. That is, you do it for half an hour and then you say, I'm a leader. Uske baad mein performance khatam ho gayi, to wahan pe jaake then again you are doing what you have this thing like that. You are a selfish man, petty man. I have got no... You are leader everywhere. Your voice exuberates that. Your eyes say that. Your body language says that. Then only you change. Leaders get established because they behave like leaders. A good number of us in our companies, in our school, or in our these things, we don't behave like leaders. We behave petty, we behave small, and then we expect that our talk should give this. Your talk has got an impact only because it is not only your voice that speaks. Every pore of your body speaks when you interact with this world. Try to be that. When you sleep, think of yourself as that. Secondly, they were able to win their trust of their people. And they win their trust by making them believe that it is worthwhile following them. And for that, they set very high personal examples. They lead by personal example. So, if we say that is, we have to interact with the people and we have to control the people, we have to control the actions of the people, their thoughts, their ideas, then be an example before them. If you are in a job which requires a lot of courage, you should be the best man with the courage. You stake your life first. You say, we are all going on a mission. It has got a dangers. And he knew he cannot do it alone. He has to have the whole panth come up. So he wanted to create the Khalsa Panth. And then what he did was this, that okay, he had a large congregation, and that congregation he called people. He said, who are there who are prepared to die for the cause of the Panth? Let him come and give the first sacrifice. So people looked at it. And he had a big sword in his hand. And he was standing on the stage. So one person came, raised his hand. He said, you come. He took him behind the screen. The man who was seen, thereafter he came, blood on his this thing. He said, who else? So the second man came. Again he went behind the screen. Again more blood, more red blood dripping from the sword. And like that, the five persons came. He said, and that is how he created the Panch Pyaras, that they will be the one who will lead the Panch. Actually, he had not killed them. He had kept the goats on the other side. And he was slaughtering the goats, but making people believe that, are you prepared to make the highest sacrifice? Do you have that level of trust and determination and confidence? If people had it in him, he knew he would be able to lead. If he has to lead, he does not want himself to be leading. He wants others. He wants the support of others. He created leaders. So the leader creates other leaders. He positions themselves. He instructs. He shapes them. He grooms them. He encourages them. He works on their strengths. He is not bothered about his weaknesses. He capitalizes on their strengths. He builds their strengths. Problem. We have now been encircled. Probably we will die. But our change objective is we will inflict maximum casualties on our enemy before we die. Let us all prepare for that. That is the objective now. Vital is not saving the life. Vital is taking as many lives that we can. So, to keep the morale high, you change the narrative. You don't tell the lies, which the politicians normally do. You know, they'll say, aisa nahi hai, kuch nahi hai, baat ho gayi hai, there is no intrusion from China. We have got 570 intrusions from China in the last 2 years. Nothing is happening, we are talking and things like that. No, that doesn't build the morale. Tell the truth. Say it is there. Say we are determined. What can we do? How we are going to do that? Move fast. Take quick decisions. Be decisive. Accept affordable losses and move ahead. I'll tell you about this. I think just the last one before I conclude. He tells me the last time. One of the finest examples in history that I find is about an incident when Shivaji went to meet Afzal Khan about the handling the crisis and preparing for the crisis. Now he had trained a man who could carry a this thing sling and then cut a this thing like that. His name was Jiva Malla. Now when Afzal Khan came, Afzal Khan had a sinister plan. He wanted to this thing with the sword. And he also brought with him Sayyid Bada, who was a great swordsman. The idea was this, that after he is able to kill Shivaji, he will also come to his rescue. Now, Jiva Malla was given one job, that in case, and you know, Shivaji had trained him for long. It was decided that the bodyguards will stay 20 yards on both sides away from each other. So after Bagnaks were used by Shivaji, Sayyid Banda, who was a very tall man and a great swordsman, another, he rushed towards Shivaji. And Jiva Malla, this thing, his sling, and cut his hand along with the sword in the ear. That is what he had been trained, and that is what Shivaji had done, the contingency planning, handling the crisis. Should that happen? And then he had this thing, that how after that he will move away from the Pratapgarh. So handling the crisis is another this thing. But anyway, I think there are plenty of things and there are plenty that can be done, and each one of you are a potential leader, and if you have to change the nation, each one of you has to lead the change and be the change yourself and lead the country to the change. Thank you very much. You want to do the question answers?
Yeah. Wow. What an enlightening and inspiring speech. Sure, it must have triggered your thought processes and questions must be sprouting out. Before we start this question and answer session, my humble request to all of you to please keep your question crisp, brief and to the point, and please avoid dialogues. I have my two colleagues helping me in this session, Mrs. Sheetal, where are you? Mrs. Sheetal is on my right and Mr. Vilas is on my left. If you have any questions, please raise your hand, they'll come to you. Please, with the first question. Yes, Srikant sir.
Sir, appreciate the excellent... I'm here. Appreciate...
I'm this side.
Yeah. Appreciate the excellent thoughts you have shared with us. What I would like to ask is, in this consumption society where people's idea of success is only to build bigger, have a house, then a bigger house, and a bigger house, and have a car, and a bigger car, and then a bigger car, how do you reconcile this selflessness which you talked about for having great leadership?
You know, this is a question of personal choice and a personal morality and the values in life. I totally agree that the determinant of success is going to be material prosperity, then the limit of your growth is very, very small. You can, you know, it's like this, with the wings of a sparrow, you can only go 50 feet high. If you want to go for 5,000 feet high, you must have the wings of eagle. So, but we cannot deny it that a large number of people in any society would always be looking for only their personal gratifications and improving their level of material satisfaction. Personally, I don't think that that's the best thing to happen, but if that be so, let us try to see. That is, can we convert it into a national strength? After all, even the material prosperity of the people can lead to some very desirable effects. People can go and make big houses, but they can also send their schools to children to best of schools. They can do philanthropic work. They can make schools and hospitals. They can add to the society and things like that. If we can change their values, it is all right. But if I say that let us try to make an India a highly moralistic society in which people will not take care of themselves, probably it will be little less practical and striving to do a thing which is not doable.
There are different forces, ये temptation के कारण different forces different तरफ खींचते हैं. ऐसे समय में जब leader की team बड़ी होती है, how he should manage it?
नहीं, जरा फिर से कहिएगा कुछ मुझे.
ये leadership के अंदर में team बड़ी चाहिए.
हाँ.
और team में different forces different thing में खींचते हैं.
हाँ.
sir, इसमें child भी है, old age के भी आदमी है, तो generation gap भी है.
हाँ.
जैसा आज बिजनेस के अंदर में अकाउंट्स वाला भी है, प्रोडक्शन वाला भी है, ये भी सब अपने अपने कंपार्टमेंट बना के बैठते हैं, ऐसे में कैसे लीडरशिप को मैनेज करते हैं?
हाँ, देखिए, ये एक प्रोसेस के अंदर में प्रॉब्लम तो जरूर आती है, लेकिन ये इट्स अ क्वेश्चन द लीडर्स रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी टू बिल्ड सिस्टम्स को बनाने की क्षमता. और सिस्टम्स को बनाने की क्षमता में तीन बातें महत्वपूर्ण है. एक तो ये कि जो डिफरेंट सेगमेंट्स हैं या डिफरेंट कैटेगराइजेशन हैं उनके अंदर में सीमलेस कनेक्टिविटी एंड कोऑर्डिनेशन हो. कि क्या आप सिस्टमिक इंटीग्रेशन लाइए. अगर आप फिजिकल इंटीग्रेशन लाएंगे तो प्रॉब्लम जरूर आएंगी. अगर आपके सिस्टम्स के द्वारा वो इंटीग्रेट होते हैं तो एक चीज ऑटोमेटिकली दूसरी चीज में परिवर्तित होती है, दूसरी चीज में वो होती है. तो दैट इज कनेक्टिविटी एंड कोऑर्डिनेशन. दूसरी बात यह होती है कि दैट आप उन सबको एक कॉमन धागे से बांधते हैं, जिसे हम कहते हैं शेयरिंग ए कॉमन कॉज एंड एन ऑब्जेक्टिव. क्योंकि अब देखिए, मान लो फौज है, फौज के अंदर में आर्मर कोर भी, आर्टिलरी भी है, तो रिमाउंट वेटरनरी कोर भी है, मतलब खच्चरों की पलटन भी है ना, और आर्मी एजुकेशन कोर भी है. लेकिन सबके सब यही सोचते हैं कि हम भारत के लिए वो कर रहे हैं. अगर विवेकानंद केंद्र कई तरह के काम कर रहा है, तो नॉर्थ ईस्ट में काम कर रहा है, अरुणाचल प्रदेश में काम कर रहा है, कन्याकुमारी में काम कर रहा है, दिल्ली के अंदर विवेकानंद फाउंडेशन है, तो सब संस्थाएं मूल रूप से एक डेडिकेटेड एंड कमिटेड फील करती हैं एक उस लार्जर कॉज एंड विजन के साथ में जो एकनाथ जी का था. तो आप एक उस लार्जर आइडिया को, जो कि एक सीमेंटिंग आइडिया होता है, उस लार्जर आइडिया को क्रिएट करते हैं. ये लीडर की जिम्मेदारी होती है कि उस लार्जर आइडिया को क्रिएट करता है जिसमें सब समाहित हो जाते हैं, सबके सब उसके अंदर में ये होते हैं. और तीसरी बात यह है मेरे ख्याल से, जो कि है कि लीडर का अपना नॉलेज और अपनी कॉम्पिटेंस और अपनी इनोवेटिवनेस एंड प्रॉब्लम सॉल्विंग कैपेबिलिटी इतनी अधिक हो कि जब वो किसी को कोई चीज में परिवर्तन या उसके करना चाहता है तो उसके लिए उसको रेजिस्टेंस नहीं होता। वो प्रॉब्लम क्या होती है कि मान लीजिए अब आपका एक अकाउंट का सेशन है, एक प्रोडक्शन का है, एक इसका है, कि आपकी रीट उतनी उस गहराई से या उस मुस्तैदी से उतनी एफिशिएंसी के साथ में नहीं चलती जितना आप चलाना चाहते, क्योंकि वो रेजिस्टेंस इनबिल्ट होता है। वो तब नहीं होता है जबकि पीपल टेक यू एज द मास्टर, एज द हेड एंड शोल्डर अबाउट एवरीवन, एंड दैट हैपेंस बिकॉज यू सॉल्व द प्रॉब्लम्स, यू टेक द रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी एंड यू आर द वन हु अल्टीमेटली people believe that he has got the solution. So you have got to be the problem giver. क्योंकि वो जो accounts का आती है उसकी genuine problem है। मैं उस ये मैं नहीं कह रहा हूँ कि फेन कर रहा है, उसकी genuine problem है। अगर genuine problem है तो उसके लिए genuine solution भी ढूंढिए, और अगर genuine solution ढूंढना है तो ये नेतृत्व का काम है।
सर मैं इधर से बोलूँ, मेरा हेलो हेलो हेलो, मैं एक छोटा सा क्वेश्चन पूछना चाहता
हूँ। इधर से भी है उधर से?
हाँ, दिल्ली से संबंधित है। आप अरविंद केजरीवाल को किस तरीके की लीडरशिप मांगते हैं और क्या देश का राजनीतिक भविष्य बदलेंगे क्या?
देखिए, मैंने एक बात कही थी, लीडरशिप के लिए यह बहुत आवश्यक है कि ट्रस्टवर्दीनेस हो। ट्रस्टवर्दीनेस की यह बात है कि लीडर ट्रस्टवर्दी है, यह पूर्ण रूप से लोगों में वो होना चाहिए। मैं जिस एरिया में रहता हूं दिल्ली के अंदर में, मेरे बगल में वो वाइस चीफ ऑफ द आर्मी स्टाफ मेरे बगल में ही रहते हैं, मेरे पुराने दोस्त भी हैं, वो आम आदमी पार्टी के बहुत बड़े सपोर्टर थे। 3-4 दिन पहले वो मेरे पास में आए, उन्होंने कहा यार ये तो बहुत बड़ा फ्रॉड है, ये तो ही डज नॉट वॉन्ट टू डू एनीथिंग दैट ही प्रॉमिस्ड पीपल। जब इन्होंने मूवमेंट स्टार्ट किया था तब तो कहा था करप्शन की बात, तब तो कोई करप्शन की बात ही नहीं करता। उसके बाद में इन्होंने जैसे वो बात कई सारी बातें आई और वो कहने लगे कि वो अपनी ट्रस्टवर्दीनेस खो रहे हैं, लेकिन एक आशा लोगों में पैदा कर रहे हैं सेल्फ इंटरेस्ट की, कि अगर हम आएंगे तो शायद हम मोदी को रोक लेंगे, शायद हम इसको ये कर लेंगे। और जब यह आ गया है कि क्योंकि ये कांग्रेस का एक वो उसका प्लैंक है, तो इससे मेरे ख्याल से ये लॉन्ग टर्म के एक पॉलिटिकल अल्टरनेटिव के रूप में उभर पाएंगे, ये मुझे नहीं लगता। लेकिन इस इलेक्शन में ये एक स्टम्बलिंग फोर्स की तरीके से आए, कुछ वो कर सकें, ये एक संभावना बन सकती है। लेकिन ये कि आज से 20 साल के बाद 25 साल के बाद देश के सामने एक ऐसा अल्टरनेटिव पैदा हो रहा है जो राष्ट्र को आगे ले जाएगा, जिसका नेशन के बारे में एक विजन है, जो देश को एक प्रगति की राह पे ले जाने के लिए कमिटेड है, और वो है, वो नहीं लगता। जिस तरीके से एक बेसिकली ये एक पॉपुलिस्ट मेजर्स हैं, वो ट्रस्ट जनरेट नहीं करेंगे, ऐसा मेरा वो है, लेकिन ये मेरा निजी विचार है।
Good evening, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, you have lived such a life that which we can only watch in movies on itself. Yeah. Sir, could you please share some of the incidents of leadership or management from your career?
चलिए, आज समय बहुत ज़्यादा हो गया, वो कभी
करें। Sir, only one. Sir, I heard that you were in Pakistan for 5 years.
Seven years.
7 years. Wow.
Yeah, I lived.
Sir, any such incident of dharma sankat, like you had to make some decision. Either this or that.
मैं आपको एक छोटी सी घटना सुनाता हूँ, ये इसलिए क्योंकि किसी ने अखबार में छापी थी कुछ साल पहले। ऐसा हुआ कि वहां पर एक लाहौर के अंदर में एक बड़ी भारी वो है औलिया की एक मजार है जिसपे बहुत सारे लोग आते हैं। तो नेचुरली मैं क्योंकि एक मुस्लिम उसमें रहता था और उसके साथ में रहता था, तो मैं वहाँ से गुजर रहा था और मैं उस अलिया के उसमें आया और मस्जिद से वापस आया और एक उसमें मिला। तो एक आदमी एक कोने पे बैठा हुआ था, बड़ी आकर्षक उसका व्यक्तित्व था, बड़ी सफेद लंबी दाढ़ी थी। उसने मुझे बुलाया, उसने कहा तुम हिंदू हो? मैंने कहा नहीं। कहता मेरे साथ आओ, मैं उसके साथ चला गया। वो मुझे 2-4 गलियां ले जाके छोटे से कमरे में ले गया, उसने दरवाजा बंद कर दिया। उसने कहा देखो तुम हिंदू हो, मैंने कहा आप क्यों कहते हैं ये? कहने उसने कहा देखिए आपके कान छिदे हुए हैं। अब पता नहीं बचपन में हमारे यहाँ एक प्रथा है, मैं जहां का रहने वाला हूं, कि कानों को छेदने के एक कान वेदन का एक वो होता है, एक वो है। अब शायद कम हो गई है, लड़कों के नहीं अब लड़कियों की होती है, लेकिन हमारे मेरे टाइम पे लड़कों की भी होती थी। तो मैंने कहा हाँ ये तो है कि मैं जब पैदा हुआ था तो वे था, मैंने कहा मैं बाद में कन्वर्ट हुआ। उसने कहा तुम बाद में भी कन्वर्ट नहीं हुए। खैर उसने कहा कि इसकी प्लास्टिक सर्जरी करवा लो, इस तरह से घूमना ठीक नहीं है। मैंने कहा अच्छा। खैर वो मैंने करवा ली या नहीं करा, इसके बाद में भी है, दिखाई देते हैं, कम दिखाई देते हैं पर दिखाई देते हैं। लेकिन मैंने कहा ये बताइए इतनी सूक्ष्म दृष्टि और इतना नहीं, मैंने कहा, उसने कहा देखो पता है मैंने ऐसा क्यों कहा? मैंने कहा क्यों? उसने कहा क्योंकि मैं भी हिंदू हूं। और उसने कहा कि देखो मेरा सारा परिवार इन लोगों ने मार दिया था, मैं यहां पर किसी तरह से अपने दिन काट रहा हूं, मुझको बहुत खुशी होती है जब आप लोगों को देखता हूं, लेकिन मैंने भी अपना बेस बदला हुआ है। लेकिन देखो इस कमरे के अंदर, और फिर उसने कलमारी खोली, उसके अंदर में एक शिव जी की और एक दुर्गा की एक वो रखी थी। उसने कहा देखो मैं इनकी पूजा करता हूँ, लेकिन बाहर जाकर मस्जिद के अंदर में सब लोग मेरे को यहाँ का एक रिस्पेक्टेड उलेमा समझ लीजिए, उलेमा तो नहीं लेकिन वो समझ लीजिए, मतलब रिलीजियस मैन की तरीके से वो करते हैं। ये एक छोटी सी घटना है लेकिन बड़ी मेरे को वो लगी। कभी मेरी में इच्छा भी होती थी कि मैं उनकी कोई मदद कर सकता या हो सकता, लेकिन कभी ऐसा हुआ नहीं, लेकिन वो ऐसा था। चलिए
राइट इन द बिगिनिंग यू मेंशन्ड अबाउट बीइंग लेड एंड लीडिंग, बीइंग लेड बीइंग अ फॉलोअर एंड लीडिंग, सो कैन यू मेंशन अ फ्यू क्वालिटीज ऑफ बीइंग अ गुड फॉलोअर, बीइंग अ गुड सबॉर्डिनेट एक्सेप्ट सेल्फ बिलीफ और बिलीविंग इन दैट लीडर? Yes. That you have already mentioned. Thank you, sir.
I am very happy that this question has been asked. Particularly, this question is very relevant for the younger generation. Let me tell you one thing, that you cannot be a good leader if you have not been a good follower. Agar Swami Vivekananda ji, Ramakrishna ji ke prati unke wo shraddha aur wo nahi hota, to shayad jinka Swami ji ke prati baad mein wo shraddha aur vishwas paida hua, un par bhi nahi hota. Jo bahut avashyak hai. To be a good follower or a good lead and this thing like that, etc. अब मैं ये बात कह रहा हूं, मैं ये नहीं कहता हूं कि आप इस बात को स्वीकार करें या न करें, लेकिन मैं स्वीकार करता हूं, मेरे जीवन का अनुभव है, उसके आधार पर कह रहा हूं। सो इट इज दिस, हैव ब्लाइंड फेथ इन योर लीडर। अब मुझे मालूम है नई जनरेशन इसको नहीं मानेगी, पर मेरा हमेशा यह था, गुड और बैड, जिस आदमी को मैं अपने उसकी वो करता हूं, उसकी नियत पर, उसकी दूरदर्शिता पर, उसकी इंटीग्रिटी पर मेरा पूर्ण विश्वास था। मुझे नहीं मालूम, मैं भगवान तो नहीं हूं कि सच था कि गलत था। आज के जमाने में इस उम्र में आके नाउ आई एम 70, मुझे लगता है कि शायद हो सकता है कि सभी लोग वैसे नहीं है जैसे मैं समझता था, लेकिन मैं कम से कम अपने फॉर्मेटिव ईयर्स के अंदर में मैं उनको भगवान के रूप में समझता था, सुपर ह्यूमन समझता था, और मैं दिल से समझता था, मुझको लगता था ये वाकई में बहुत वो है। ये हैव द फेथ, उससे पता नहीं वो हैं कि नहीं हैं, लेकिन आपको बहुत लाभ होगा। जब आप श्रद्धा और विश्वास के साथ में काम करेंगे तो आपकी मेहनत बड़ी फलीभूत होगी, और वो चाहे कितना ही बड़ा फ्रॉड हो, लेकिन जब वो आपको कोई बात कहेगा तो अपने पर्सनल इंटरेस्ट के लिए भी कहेगा, लेकिन जब आप काम करेंगे या मेहनत करेंगे, प्रॉफिट चाहे उसका भी हो, हुनर तो आपका भी बढ़ेगा। सो बी ए वेरी वेरी दिस थिंग, हैव अ टोटल फेथ एंड थिंग्स लाइक दैट एटसेट्रा। Secondly, never try to compete and outdo your superior. Never make him feel, give him a sense of insecurity. If you think that will he beats you and you will become his rival, and tomorrow probably you will have this thing. आजकल के corporate world के अंदर में तो है ही है. I join your company, I am your partner, and after some time I have got another board opposite yours, and half your clients I have taken. And then you know you have always to be very careful that while I am your colleague, I am also your potential rival and things like that. So never give that sense of this thing to. That is, do little more than what you normally is expected of you. That additionality makes all the difference. That additionality in terms of your time, that additionality in terms of your production, in terms of your contribution, in terms of your hard work, in terms of your output and things like that, etc., that helps a lot. That establishes you. And that is the one which also differentiates you from the rest. So that additionality takes a little more effort, but have a, this thing of that. But I think to be a good leader at some stage, you have got to be a good follower for a long time, and to be a good follower, you must have total faith and this thing in the cause for which your organization or your profession exists. If you are a doctor, then you must have this thing. That is, this is a noble profession, I want to be at it, stop, and I have this thing. If you don't have a faith in the cause, better leave it and do something in which you have got a faith. It's the worst life can be, that is, you are living a life that you don't want to live. Thank you very much. So that is the close of it.
Hello sir, good evening.
Yes.
हम सालों से जो पाकिस्तान और चाइना का जो प्रॉब्लम फेस कर रहा है इंडिया वो कमजोर लीडरशिप के कारण है ऐसा आपको लगता है क्या?
ये तो बड़ा आपने लंबा क्वेश्चन पूछ लिया. हाँ नहीं नहीं मैं आपको एक बात बता, कमजोर लीडरशिप के कारण है, लेकिन वो कमजोर लीडरशिप कमजोर क्यों है उसका भी एक कारण है. मैंने सिर्फ वही कारण नहीं है जो आप इलेक्शन के बारे में सोचते हैं. मतलब इलेक्शंस के बारे में तो कहेंगे ना कि सरकार बेकार है, सरकार के अंदर भी ये है. सरकार के कमजोर होने के कई सारे कारण हैं और इस कारण लीडरशिप की भी कमजोर है. लीडरशिप कमजोर इसलिए है क्योंकि हम लोगों ने, ये लीडरशिप के लिए भी इंपॉर्टेंट है और गवर्नमेंट्स को चलाने के लिए भी इंपॉर्टेंट है. एक कंफ्लिक्ट हमेशा रहता है, इमीडिएट वर्सेस इंपॉर्टेंट, लाइफ में भी होता है. अगर कोई चीज इस वक्त में हो रही है तो वो मेरे लिए इमीडिएट बन जाती है, हालांकि लाइफ में बहुत इंपॉर्टेंट नहीं है. लीडरशिप जो है वो हमेशा इमीडिएट सॉल्यूशंस की तरफ गई और फायर फाइटिंग में लगी और इंपॉर्टेंट डिसीजंस को उसने वो कर दिया. अब इंडिया का जो मिलिट्री बिल्डअप है उसको अगर हमको बनाना पड़े तो हमको कम से कम 15-20 साल का प्लान चाहिए. अब क्या हुआ, जब हमें आजादी मिली थी उस वक्त वेस्टर्न कंट्रीज के अलावा दुनिया में भारत के अंदर में सबसे ज्यादा ऑर्डिनेंस डिफेंस इक्विपमेंट बिल्डिंग कैपेबिलिटी थी. 32 ऑर्डिनेंस फैक्ट्री थी आपके यहां भी, पुरानी ऐसे की ये भी पुरानी है, यहां पर कैलकटा के अंदर में थी, इसके अंदर में थी, क्योंकि 1822 से लेके 1882 से लेके हम लोगों ने मैन्युफैक्चरिंग ब्रिटिशर्स ने शुरू कर दिया था तो यहां पर बन रहा था, बाकी कंट्रीज में नहीं बन रहा था. सेकेंड वर्ल्ड वार के दौरान में हमारी एरोनॉटिकल वर्क या वालचंद वगैरह का जो था, यहाँ पर अमेरिकन प्लेन्स भी सर्विसिंग के लिए यहीं आते थे, गार्डन रीच वर्कशॉप, मेजागन डॉक, इस तरह से हमारा एक डिफेंस बिल्डअप था. चाइना में कुछ नहीं था. अब चाइना अपना एक भी एयरक्राफ्ट इंपोर्ट नहीं करता. चाइना K-17 एयरक्राफ्ट बना रहा है जो हम रफल के मुकाबले का है, जिसको हम फ्रांस से ले रहे हैं. अब उन्होंने सस्टेन्ड तरीके से अपनी डिफेंस कैपेबिलिटी बनाई इन स्पाइट ऑफ द फैक्ट दे हैड नो इंडस्ट्रियल बेस, इन स्पाइट ऑफ द फैक्ट दैट वी हैड अ बिग इंडस्ट्रियल बेस, इन स्पाइट ऑफ द फैक्ट दैट वी हैड अ बिगर पूल ऑफ साइंटिस्ट एंड टेक्नोलॉजिस्ट, वी हैव गॉट द वर्ल्ड द थर्ड लार्जेस्ट पूल ऑफ साइंटिस्ट एंड टेक्नोलॉजिस्ट, दे हैड नो दिस. इन स्पाइट ऑफ द फैक्ट दैट वी हैड एक्सेस टू इंग्लिश नॉलेज एंड अवर चिल्ड्रन कुड गो टू ऑल द फॉरेन यूनिवर्सिटीज एंड अदर, चाइनीज एट दैट टाइम डिड नॉट हैव दिस. And in spite of the fact that we being a democracy and an open country had relatively till we went for the nuclear bomb were able to get the technologies from the rest of the world, including the Russian technology, which the Chinese were denied not only by the West but also by the Russians till very late, you know, later after 1990 it has started. But as you know that this thing, in spite of that, Chinese build up their capability. Hindustan 70% of its defense production ke liye foreign countries par wo hai. Hum bade fakr ke sath mein kehte hain ki agle 7 saal ke andar mein hum $100 billion ki cheez import karenge. Hum apne yahan ki jo aapke paas mein police wale ke paas mein ya pistol bhi hai, ye water resistant ki ya 9mm ki hai, ye bhi Czechoslovakia se aati hai. Jabki hamare paas mein technological capability itni hai ki hum Mars ke upar mein apna mangalyaan डालने की भी सोच रहे हैं, लेकिन वेस्टेड इंटरेस्ट है. इसलिए हम लोगों ने अपनी उन क्षमताओं को जहां पर जो हमारे पास में थी, जो वहां पर हमारे पास में साइंटिफिक टैलेंट था, जहां पर हमारे पास इन्वेस्टेबल सरप्लस था, जहां पर हमारे पास में एक इंडस्ट्रियल इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर और ऑर्डिनेंस फैक्ट्रीज का और डिफेंस प्रोडक्शन का बेस था, एक R&D का बेस था, DRDO जो थी बहुत पुरानी ऑर्गेनाइजेशन है, एटॉमिक एनर्जी कमीशन थी। देखिए स्पेस में, एटॉमिक एनर्जी में, ओशनोग्राफी में, मिसाइल्स में, जहां जहां हमने किया वी आर वर्ल्ड क्लास। लेकिन आप अपने आप MP5 राइफल्स बनाने नहीं देंगे, आप आर्टिलरी कॉम्बिनेशन बनाए दे, बोफोर्स का हमने 85 के बाद दिया, वेट कर रहे हैं दूसरा, हम आर्टिलरी गन मंगाए, हमने आर्टिलरी गन नहीं, एयर डिफेंस सिस्टम के लिए हम लोगों ने अभी तक कोई वेपन नहीं, वो नहीं हमारे पास, है ही नहीं एयर डिफेंस सिस्टम। हमारे 80% टैक्स जो है उनमें नाइट विजन कैपेबिलिटी नहीं है, पाकिस्तान ने 100% कर दिया, हमारे 80-72 टैंक्स है वो भी बिना नाइट विजन कैपेसिटी के, लार्ज नंबर ऑफ देम। हम अर्जुन टैंक बना रहे थे, मेन बैटल टैंक, उसको गवर्नमेंट ने वो चलने नहीं दिया। एक एयरक्राफ्ट बनाने की कोशिश कर रहे थे, लाइट कॉम्बैट एयरक्राफ्ट LCA तेजस, वो अब उड़ा तो है लेकिन उसके लिए भी इतनी सारी रेजिस्टेंस है और उसका भी इतना सारा इक्विपमेंट अब हम इंपोर्ट कर रहे हैं। तो जो एक प्लान तरीके से नेशन बिल्डिंग का विजन होना चाहिए था वो लीडरशिप का कमजोर था, ये सोच के कि 5 साल में तो इलेक्शन होने, 2.5 साल तो हो गया, अब आप मुझे कह रहे हैं इसका वो करने के लिए इम्पैक्ट होगा इसका 15 साल के बाद में, 10 साल के बाद में, 12 साल के बाद में। एयरक्राफ्ट कैरियर चाइना अपना बना रहा है, खैर हम भी अपना बना रहे हैं गार्डन वर्कशॉप में, लेकिन हम लोगों ने इतना महंगा जो है वर्कशॉप को लिया जो उसे विक्रमादित्य के नाम से ले रहे हैं। तो ये जो बातें हैं इसके लिए लॉन्गर गेस्टेशन की, इमीडिएट टेक्स द प्रेसिडेंस ओवर इम्पॉर्टेंट। तो इमीडिएट में आपने कहा कि मनरेगा कर दो तो वोट मिल जाएंगे, या छोटी छोटी चीजें, क्योंकि उसका इमीडिएट इम्पैक्ट, आज पैसा दिया कल 6 महीने के अंदर, साल भर के अंदर, 2 साल के अंदर में लोगों को उसका फायदा हुआ, लेकिन राष्ट्र तो नहीं बना। आपने जितना वो कैपिटल था उसके अगर ये करते तो इन्हीं ऑनलाइन फैक्ट्री में उन लोगों को रोजगार मिलता, उनकी कैपेबिलिटीज बनती, हॉस्पिटल बनते, रोड्स बनते, इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर बनता, है ना, ओवरऑल वो होता, शायद हिंदुस्तान जो था वर्ल्ड का सबसे बड़ा आर्मामेंट एक्सपोर्टर कंट्री बन सकता था, क्योंकि हम नॉन अलाइन कंट्री थे। तो जितना भी अंडर डेवलप्ड वर्ल्ड है वो, क्योंकि इन वेपन्स को लेने में एक बड़ी प्रॉब्लम है, क्योंकि वेपन्स तो एक होती है और वेपन्स के एक्चुअल ये तो मशीन का टुकड़ा है जिसका तो अमुनेशन इंपॉर्टेंट होता है, और अमुनेशन आप एक साथ बहुत लिख के नहीं रख सकते क्योंकि उसकी एक शेल्फ लाइफ होती है, 6 महीने, साल, साल डेढ़ साल के अंदर में यूज नहीं हुआ तो उसके बाद में बेकार होता है। अब जब लड़ाई लगती है तो एक तो इसकी प्राइसेस वो करीबन कम से कम 7 या 8 गुना बढ़ा देते हैं, दूसरी बात वो कंडीशन ले करते हैं कि साहब नहीं, अगर आप पाकिस्तान के सामने लड़ाई करेंगे तो हम नहीं देंगे, कश्मीर इशू के ऊपर में हम तो यूनाइटेड नेशंस के अंदर पाकिस्तान को सपोर्ट कर रहे हैं, या हमारे चाइना के साथ में वो है तो, लेकिन जो हमारे इंडिजिनस प्रोडक्शन के वेपन्स होते हैं उसके ऊपर में हमारे ऊपर में कोई रिस्ट्रिक्शन नहीं होते। तो एक बड़ा सवाल है हमारी जो डिफेंस कैपेबिलिटी बिल्ड करने की चाइना की विदर्भ, ये देखिए हिंदुस्तान एटॉमिक कैपेबिलिटी भाभा साहब के टाइम पर 1954 में कर सकता था, 1968 के अंदर में नॉन प्रोलिफरेशन ट्रीटी आई, आने वाली थी तो हम उस वक्त में टोटल इस पोजीशन में थे कि न्यूक्लियर ब्लास्ट कर देते, चाइना ने कर दिया। तो सर न्यू UN का रेजोल्यूशन बना कि जिन लोगों ने अब तक कर दिया वो तो न्यूक्लियर पावर्स कही जाएंगी और जो नहीं करेंगे उन पे NPT लग जाएगा, नॉन प्रोलिफरेशन ट्रीटी, और वो प्रोलिफरेशन नहीं कर सकती, अगर करेंगे तो इंटरनेशनल सैंक्शन लग जाएंगे। तो इंडिया ने जो है वो वॉलंटियरली वो कर दिया कि हम नहीं करेंगे, कहा भी गया, नेहरू जी से भी कहा गया, फिर बाद में भी कहा गया, लेकिन वो नहीं किया, और क्योंकि चाइना ने कर दिया तो अब चाइना के ऊपर में कोई चक नहीं है, वो अपना न्यूक्लियर आर्सेनल 450 उन्होंने कर दिया और भी जितना बढ़ा सके उस पर कोई चक नहीं। हिंदुस्तान अगर एक पोखरण के अंदर में टेस्ट करता है तो कहते हैं कि साहब इंडिया ने जो है वो न्यूक्लियर इसके ऊपर में सारी इंटरनेशनल सैंक्शन लगनी शुरू हो जाती है। आज स्पेस के अंदर में अभी यूनाइटेड नेशंस ने वो बनाया नहीं है, बनाने वाला है, ये बनाने वाला है सोच के चाइना ने स्पेस के अंदर में वेपन डाल दिया, कहां पे डाला, अपना ही सैटेलाइट मार दिया, अपने ही सैटेलाइट को, एक फेलो सैटेलाइट था जिसको वो यूज नहीं कर रहे थे, उन्होंने स्पेस के अंदर में स्पेस सैटेलाइट को हिट कर दिया। किस लिए कर दिया, ताकि जब लोग कहेंगे हमारी तो स्पेस कैपेबिलिटी 2012 में थी, 2013 में थी, तो अब इसके बाद में स्पेस कैपेबिलिटी पे मना होगा। इंडिया स्पेस के अंदर में बहुत ज्यादा एडवांस्ड है, इंडिया स्पेस वेपन सिस्टम्स के बारे में तैयार नहीं, स्टार वॉर्स के बारे में हम लोग कहते हैं नहीं नहीं ये तो हमारे सिद्धांत के खिलाफ, और दूसरी बात इसका कोई पॉलिटिकल लाभ भी नहीं होगा, हिंदुस्तान को समझेगा भी नहीं, कितने वोट मिलेंगे स्पेस पे कर, ये भी बात है ना। तो ये लंबा चौड़ा सवाल है, चलिए पर फिर भी अच्छा है कि आप इस तरह की बातों के बारे में सोचते हैं, बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद।
ओके रंजीत, दिस विल बी द लास्ट,
चलिए दो यार, इतना सब लोग
सर जी, निगोसिएशन स्किल्स हम लोग जब बिजनेस में करते हैं तो एटलीस्ट दोनों पार्टीज का कोई ना कोई इंटरेस्ट रहता है. मैं बिजनेस में जब निगोशिएट करता हूँ किसी से तो कोई ना कोई दोनों का इंटरेस्ट है, तभी तो निगोशिएट करने आया है. लेकिन जब आप निगोशिएट करते हैं किसी टेररिस्ट से, जैसा आपने कंधार के केस में किया था, तो उसमें कैसे, मतलब व्हाट आर द स्किल्स एसोसिएटेड?
देखिए ऐसा है कि जब टेररिस्ट से नेगोशिएट किया जाता है तो वास्तव में ये नेगोशिएशन नहीं होता, ये एक टैक्टिक्स होती है टेररिस्ट को न्यूट्रलाइज करने की. क्योंकि जब मान लिया जाए कि हमारा हवाई जहाज है और वो कंधार चला गया, अब हम इस वक्त में हमारी इमीडिएट रिक्वायरमेंट्स क्या हैं, वाइटल्स क्या हैं, लोगों की जान सुरक्षित रखी जाए, जो लोग हैं उनको वो नहीं किया जाए, जो टेररिस्ट की मांगे हैं उनको कम किया जाए या नीचे लाया जाए या खत्म किया जाए या उनको ये किया जाए, और अगर हम इन टेररिस्ट को वो कर सके, कैप्चर कर सके, तो हम इनको न्यूट्रलाइज करें. तो इसके लिए हम लोग क्या करते हैं कि हम कहते हैं कि भाई चलो अब तो हम बातचीत करते हैं, अब कोई रास्ता निकालेंगे. हम टाइम गेन कर रहे हैं, टाइम गेन करते हैं ये सोच के कि इसमें टेररिस्ट टायर आउट हो जाएंगे, क्योंकि वो तो अंदर है, ना खाना है, ना मेडिसिन है, ना वो है. और जो जिस भी कंट्री में सिवाय कंधार के, जहां पर कि तालिबान उनकी मदद कर रहे थे और ISI उनकी मदद कर रही थी, तो मोस्ट ऑफ द कंट्रीज ऑफ द वर्ल्ड तो उनको सपोर्ट नहीं करेंगे, तो उनकी सिक्योरिटी फोर्सेस भी उनको सराउंड कर रहे होते, तो उनको ये भी रहता है किसी वक्त भी किसी उससे आ सकते हैं, छत से आ सकते हैं, ऊपर से आ सकते हैं, नीचे की प्लेट काट के आ सकते हैं, कॉकपिट के लोअर होल से आ सकते हैं, तो वो इस सेंस ऑफ इनसिक्योरिटी में रहते हैं. तो ये रखा है एक दिन, दो दिन, तीन दिन, चार दिन के बाद में ये इनकी फिजिकल फिटनेस, इनका मेंटल वो हो जाएगा, तो फिर हम इसको, आपको उनके बारे में इंटेलिजेंस गैदर करने का मौका मिल जाता है कि वो कितने हैं, क्या उनके पास में वेपन्स हैं, कहाँ कहाँ उनकी पोजिशंस हैं, किस किस तरह का वो है, तो आप ज्यादा ऑर्गेनाइज हो सकते हैं. आप अपने उसको डिप्लॉयमेंट को बढ़ा सकते हैं कि अगर आपने जो भी वेपन्स लाने हैं या कमांडोज लाने हैं या कहीं से आपने उनको वो करना है, ये सब करते हैं. तो बेसिकली मकसद होता है टू वैकेट द हाईजैकिंग और किडनैपिंग और रैंसम सिचुएशन. लेकिन कभी कभी सरकारों के लिए ये पॉसिबल नहीं होता है कि वो रिट्रीवल कर सके. जैसे मान लिया जाए कि चलिए टेररिस्ट से तो लड़ा जा सकता था, लेकिन तालिबान अपने टैंक ले आए कंधार में, तो उन टैंक से लड़ने के लिए तो फिर आपको ज्यादा प्रिपरेशन चाहिए. अगर वो प्रिपरेशन करनी है तो हमको अपने जहाजों में लोग ले जाने पड़ेंगे, तो हमारे को तो जहाज कहाँ से होता, लैंड लॉक्ड कंट्री है, पाकिस्तान से ऊपर से तो हमारे को फ्लाइट परमिशन दी नहीं उन्होंने, है ना, तो वो इसको तो देंगे नहीं. उसके बाद में आप ये, तो फिर ये था कि उन्होंने अगर 35 के वक्त तो आपने लिस्ट को निकाल कम करके 3 में कर दिया, उन्होंने अगर आपसे $200 मिलियन मांगे थे और ये मांगे थे, तो आपने वो डिमांड खत्म करके आप उसको मिनिमाइज करने की कोशिश करते हैं, तो वो एक तरीका होता है. लेकिन आपने बिल्कुल ठीक कहा कि नेगोशिएशंस तभी कामयाब होते हैं जबकि दोनों साइड्स का कोई ना कोई उसके अंदर में रिलेटिव म्यूचुअल इंटरेस्ट हो कि वो इसको कर सके. और नेगोशिएशन या हाईजैकिंग की स्थिति के अंदर में सरकार अपने लॉसेस को मिनिमाइज करती है, गेन उसका कोई नहीं होता. देखिए लड़ाई के अंदर में दो चीजों के लिए लड़ाई जाती है, लड़ाई के एक तो टू मैक्सिमाइज योर गेन्स या प्रॉफिट्स अगर आप बिजनेस के सेंस में कहें, और टू मिनिमाइज योर लॉसेस. कि अगर नुकसान हो रहा है तो अगर 500 आदमियों का नुकसान हो रहा है, मैंने कहा मैंने 200 का करा दिया तो 300 को बचा लिया, ये मेरा गेन है, लेकिन 200 तो फिर भी गए.
गुड इवनिंग सर. सर माय क्वेश्चन इज, एज वी आर ब्लाइंडली एक्सेप्टिंग फॉरेन गुड्स और द फॉरेन कंपनीज एंड थिंग्स, सो डू यू थिंक वी आर रिपीटिंग अ हिस्ट्री?
We are doing a
repeating a history because blindly we are trusting and blindly we are giving a government giving a permission to foreign companies and avoiding Indian goods and things. So my question is quite related to economy.
You know, your question presupposes one thing, that is we are blindly doing it. You want me to accept that position? I can. If you say that this is the assumption, whatever, anything can be proved. If the assumption is accepted, अगर आप ये कहते हैं कि assume कर लें कि ये फर्श नहीं है तो मैं हवा में टंगा हूं, ये तो खसा ही है, assumption गलत है सर, ये assumption सही नहीं है कि that there's a free entry. अगर आप इंडियन इंडस्ट्रीज पॉलिसी 1954 देखें, जो हमारे वहां हमने ग्रेजुअल कुछ एरियाज में ओपन अप किया है, लेकिन हिंदुस्तान बिल्कुल ऐसा कोई नहीं है कि कोई भी इसके अंदर वो कर सकता है. कुछ एरियाज के अंदर में गलत पॉलिसीज बनी है, जैसे कम्युनिकेशन के अंदर में हमने उनको वो किया. अब जो डिफेंस इंडस्ट्रीज में हम कह रहे हैं कि हम उनको 75% इन्वॉल्वमेंट फॉरेन डायरेक्ट इन्वेस्टमेंट वो करेंगे, वो पॉलिसी बाय पॉलिसी है कि फॉरेन डायरेक्ट इन्वेस्टमेंट हमारे को डिफेंस प्रोडक्शन के लिए करना चाहिए, अगर करना चाहिए तो कितने लेवल तक करना चाहिए, किन टर्म्स पे करना चाहिए. अगर राफेल के साथ में जो डील हुई है उसकी जो ऑफसेट पॉलिसी है 40% की, कि जितना प्रॉफिट होगा उसका 40% आप इंडिया के अंदर में वो करें, तो उस 40% के लिए कोई हमारे को क्या क्या नियम बनाने चाहिए, ये है. लेकिन ऐसा कोई ब्लैंकेट वो नहीं है, क्योंकि जितनी भी डील्स या नेगोशिएशन होती हैं वो काफ़ी ड्यू डिलिजेंस उसके अंदर में होता है और सरकार इसको बहुत करती है और पॉलिसीज के बारे में भी काफ़ी कुछ होता है. एक बात तो ये है. दूसरी बात यह है कि हम इतिहास की गलती को नहीं कर रहे हैं, लेकिन अपने में ये गलतियां हो सकती हैं, जैसे फॉरेन डायरेक्ट इन्वेस्टमेंट और मल्टी ब्रांडिंग दिस थिंग, उसके अंदर में इसका प्रभाव हमारे एम्प्लॉयमेंट जनरेशन पर, कुछ छोटे उपभोक्ताओं पर, छोटे ठेले वालों पर इसका प्रभाव हो सकता है. और ये गुड्स जो कि दुनिया के सबसे सस्ते जगहों से आने शुरू हो जाएंगे वो फिर हमारे देश में बनने बंद हो जाएंगे. जब वो देश में बनने बंद हो जाएंगे तो ऐसा 50 साल 100 साल बाद कोई कहेगा यार हिंदुस्तान में हल्दी भी होती थी किसी जमाने में, अब तो हल्दी सिर्फ कीनिया में होती है और वहाँ से जो है बहुत महंगी आती है, 500 रुपये किलो आती है, क्योंकि अब तो होती है वहाँ, यहाँ तो लोग भूल भी गए कि हल्दी होती थी, क्योंकि जितने ये स्टोर्स थे उन्होंने हल्दी बेचना शुरू किया, हल्दी उन्होंने 2 रुपये किलो बेची, पहले आप 5 रुपये किलो खरीदते थे, और क्योंकि आपको 2 रुपये किलो मिल रही है तो आप खरीदते रहे 10 साल 20 साल 25 साल 30 साल तक, 2 रुपये हुई, फिर 5 रुपये हुई, फिर 7 रुपये, फिर एक दिन 500 रुपये हुई, और फिर उस वक्त में आपकी ये, तो हमारी जो अपनी इंडिजिनस कैपेबिलिटी एंड सेल्फ सफिशिएंसी डॉटर की है, तो ये पॉलिसी उसके बारे में गलत हो सकती है. लेकिन ये इतिहास को दोहराना नहीं है, ये नई गलतियों को एक नए परिप्रेक्ष्य में देखने की बात है. हमें हर पॉलिसी को और हर उसको देखना पड़ेगा, क्योंकि आज की दुनिया जिस तरीके से इंटीग्रेट हो रही है उसके अंदर में हम टोटली सेक्लूडेड कॉमर्शियल इंडिया और इंटरनेशनल पॉलिसीज भी नहीं बना सकते हैं, क्योंकि ये भी हमारे इंटरेस्ट में है कि हम ग्लोबली कॉम्पिटिटिव रहें. अब जैसे फर्ज कर लीजिए हमारे यहाँ से जो कच्चे माल का, अब चाइना से हमारा ट्रेड $70 बिलियन का है, अब $70 बिलियन में सीरियस इम्बैलेंस है, चाइना को हम इम्पोर्ट कम कर रहे हैं, चाइना हमारे यहाँ गणेश जी भी बना के दिवाली के टाइम पर वही बना के भेज देते हैं, ये भी उनके यहाँ से बन के आते हैं, ये तो हिंदुस्तान का कुम्हार बना सकता था ना, लेकिन क्योंकि वो फ्लड कर सकते हैं, उनके यहाँ तो कोई कॉस्ट ऑफ प्रोडक्शन और उसका रेशियो नहीं है, तो यहाँ पर ये कंज्यूमर गुड्स वो खत्म हो जाएंगे, तो बाद में आज से 100 साल के या 25 साल के बाद में कुम्हार दिए बनाने भी छोड़ देंगे, कुछ दिनों के बाद उनकी जनरेशन भूल भी जाएगी कैसे बनाते हैं, बनेंगे भी तो बड़ी लंबी कॉस्ट में बनेंगे. अब हमको ये देखने की बात है, अगर हम चाइना से ट्रेड कर रहे हैं तो क्या जो मैन्युफैक्चरिंग नीचे आ रही है तो उससे क्या लोगों की एम्प्लॉयमेंट अपॉर्चुनिटीज तो नहीं कम हो रही. अगर कंज्यूमर गुड्स के आएंगे तो कम से कम अगर महंगे भी दिया खरीदते हैं तो कम से कम 500 कुम्हारों को पॉटर्स को काम तो मिलता है, तो वो कहां का रोजगार करेंगे. लेकिन दूसरी बात है, हम क्या एक्सपोर्ट कर रहे हैं, हम तो फिनिश्ड प्रोडक्ट्स को नहीं कर रहे, हम तो रॉ मटेरियल कर रहे हैं, हम तो आयरन और भेज रहे हैं, मैंगनीज भेज रहे हैं, डोलोमाइट भेज रहे हैं, तो ये तो जो है वैल्यू एडिशन करके भेजे. अगर मान लिया जाए हम 500 टन आयरन ओर भेजते हैं और 500 टन उस आयरन ओर में इसको अगर हम इनवार स्टील या कोबाल्ट स्टील या हाई टंगस्टन अलॉयज के तरीके बनाते हैं तो उसकी कीमत में करीब 7,000 गुना इजाफा होता है, उतनी वैल्यू की उसके अंदर में. चाइना उसको लेता है, उसके लिए से स्टील बनाता है, तो हम स्टील ही बना के क्यों नहीं भेजें. अगर चाइना उस स्टील को भी फर्दर वो करके अलॉयज बनाया था तो हम उसको टेक्नोलॉजिकल अपग्रेडेशन करें. जापान जो है कारें बनाता है, टोयोटा की कारें हम सब लोग खरीदते हैं, उसकी कार जो खरीदते हैं उसके अंदर में जितना लोहा है वो सब हिंदुस्तान का ही गया हुआ, 25 रुपए का लोहा गया हुआ, 25 लाख की कार आ रही है, तो हम भी तो बना सकते हैं उस, कम से कम हम कहेंगे भाई ये पार्ट हम बना के देंगे, आप फैक्ट्री लगाइए हिंदुस्तान के अंदर, कोलोबोरेशन करिए टोयोटा के साथ में है, कर रहे हैं तो कुछ ना कुछ बारे में हो रहा है. लेकिन कई चीजें हिंदुस्तान में मेरे ख्याल से सेमी फिनिश्ड प्रोडक्ट्स या रॉ मटेरियल्स के एक्सपोर्ट पे तो बैन होना चाहिए. लेकिन मैं इकोनॉमिस्ट नहीं हूं, मैं सिक्योरिटी का आदमी हूं, मेरी बात को ज्यादा सीरियसली मत लें, लेकिन एक विचार के तौर पर सोच सकते हैं. नहीं मतलब मैं अधिकारी नहीं हूं इस बारे में कहने का, लेकिन मुझे लगता है कि अगर हमारे पास में अगर ये रॉ मटेरियल पड़ा रहेगा तो हम नहीं कर पाए तो हमारे आने वाले बच्चे नहीं तो उनके बच्चे हमारी 4 जनरेशन के बाद में उनके पास टेक्नोलॉजी होगी, पैसा होगा, कभी ना कभी हम इसका बनाएंगे तो हम इसका हवाई जहाज बना के भेजेंगे, हम ये कच्ची मिट्टी को भेज रहे हैं क्योंकि ये तो लोहा चला जाएगा.
सर गुड इवनिंग सर, You've talked about all the crises and the qualities that a leader should have. So as young students, where do we start so that we can be good leaders in the future?
No, you stand with a very great future. You know, when we were your age, we had no such options. The options that you have got today, the new generation has got so much to learn, so much to contribute, so much to achieve. Now, as far as crisis situations are concerned, crisis can take place in any generation, at any point of time, in any history, and anybody's life. Problem, the thing is this, prepare your, the part of your self-improvement program should include the program for contingency, meeting the contingencies. And for girls, I will say one thing, also plan for conflict avoidance wherever you can. Conflicts are one of the crisis situations. And it is bad to get into personal crises in life. And therefore avoid. I think it's for everybody, but I'm telling anyone, because the type of the things that one keep on hearing and things like that, etc. Don't get into the personalized crisis. There are solutions for institutionalized crises in a better way. Because you'll find there are many supporters there. But personalized crisis, we have got to take care of our own selves. So maybe that everything that is modern, everything that goes in the name of liberation, everything that goes in the name of weakening the family and weakening the family structures and the biggest social security structure of the world, even the West has started thinking that one of the reasons of its degeneration is the breakdown of the family institution. We are proud of having, for millenniums, having cherished the institution of the family. Let us not get it broken. For conflict situation and for crisis situations at personal levels, there can be no guarantee in this world bigger than the guarantee of your own family. Nobody will ever protect you. Nobody will ever, police ho jaye, kanun ban jaye, you make a legislation so that my wife can sue me for 500 rupees or 1000 rupees, or my brother can have this thing against me. You know, you think that will protect her? That is no guarantee under protection for her. Our protection is our family. We live together, we work together, we think together, and we protect each other together. When people think of ourselves as powerful families, as powerful this thing, we will be totally protected in this way. As far as institutional crises are concerned, one will have to talk about the individual these things, maybe in the losses in the farm, a stock exchange changes, or there is an attack on the nation, or a nuclear blast. That can be the thing in the contextualized. But I am taking your question more in the context of the personal situation for the young people in life that happens. Please strengthen your faith and do everything, even if there is a certain hardship and pain, to keep the institution of family very strong.
Ranjit, this will be the last.
You have done some great work on the security aspects and the problem of black money. Could you share some light on that?
No, I haven't done great work. Work is that in case there was no black money. I and Gurmurthy ji, we wrote a report or a paper. Some light I will tell you. What happened that in 2008, there was a big turmoil in the banking system and the monetary system in America and also in Germany. So they started investigating and doing many things. And then they found that there was a lot of unaccounted money which was lying. And which has been these things, and these so-called investment bankers and others had created so much of an artificial money, etc., which had drained off their economies. So they wanted, and a good number of them are the names of people from India, whose accounts are there. Since I happened to be in the intelligence, and since I had worked in many countries, including England, and then when I was in England for about 4 years, I had known some of these people, and they were almost personal friends. So somebody, I think I had gone for a lecture to, for a, this thing in Zurich, and he met me. And he said, you fellows, you Indians aren't doing anything, even Philippines is doing it, Nigeria is doing it, this thing is there. I said, yes, we must also do it, but we don't have much information. जैसे नई इंफॉर्मेशन हम आपको देते हैं थोड़ी बहुत जितनी हमको पता है, और गवर्नमेंट ऑफ जर्मनी ने तो कहा कि अगर हमको आप चिट्ठी लिख दें तो हम आपको सारी भेज देंगे, बाकी हमने एक जनरल लेटर भेज दिया सारी गवर्नमेंट को कि हमारे पास में इंफॉर्मेशन है, जो जो कंट्री चाहे हमसे ले जा सकते हैं। गवर्नमेंट ऑफ इंडिया ने उसका जवाब नहीं दिया, हमने कहा हमें तो पता नहीं, तो गवर्नमेंट ऑफ इंडिया ने तो उसका जवाब भी नहीं दिया, गवर्नमेंट ऑफ इंडिया ने उसमें रिपोर्ट भी नहीं किया, ये भी नहीं बताया किसी को, पता नहीं वो लेटर अब मुझे तो पता है ना किसने रखा है, लेकिन वो रखिए वो लेटर जो है वो फ्रीजर में चला गया, वो डीप फ्रीजर में चला गया। तो जब कुछ इन्फॉर्मेशन वो मिली तब फिर उसके बेसिस पे मैंने कुछ और लोगों से पूछा, फिर कुछ और लेता, तो कुछ इन्फॉर्मेशन जो हमारे पास में आई हमने कहा इसको पब्लिसाइज किया जाए, और तुम क्या कर सकते हो, मैं तो रिटायर्ड आदमी हूँ, बूढ़ा आदमी हूँ, कुछ मेरे में तो हो, तो हमने कहा चलो इसको जनता के सामने लाएंगे तो शायद इस देश की जनता जो है उसके अंदर एक जागृति पैदा होगी कि कुछ करना चाहिए, और कितना इसका वो हो सकता है, कितना इसका क्वांटम है, कितना इसका वो है, लेकिन हुआ नहीं इस देश में जो मेरी अपेक्षा थी, लेकिन ऐसा होता ही है, माने अपेक्षाएं पूरी नहीं हो तो उससे हतोत्साहित नहीं होना चाहिए, हमें करते रहना चाहिए। इस कंट्री मुझे इस बात का नहीं है कि वो क्या था, जो चोर है वो तो चोरी करेगा ही, जो बेईमान है वो तो बेईमानी करेगा ही, लेकिन पब्लिक लाइफ में पब्लिक डोमेन में आने के बाद में लोगों का एक इतना उदासीन भाव, वो देखकर ये लगा कि राष्ट्र के अंदर में क्या वो चेतना नहीं है, या सिर्फ अपने ही बारे में लोग सोच रहे हैं, या राष्ट्र के बारे में कोई, या उतना संगठन नहीं है, उससे थोड़ा सा ये हुआ, पर बाकी तो ये है कि उसके बाद में फिर कई सारी चीज़ें छोटी मोटी पता भी लगती रहती, पर उसके बाद मैंने भी ज़्यादा इंटरेस्ट नहीं लिया फ्रेंकली, खैर मैं बाकी कामों में भी लगा रहा, क्योंकि जो मेरा मेन वर्क है वो नेशनल सिक्योरिटी के बारे में जो मैं काम करता हूँ, लिखता हूँ, कुछ पब्लिश करता हूँ, कुछ भारत के अंदर तो मैं तो कम, क्योंकि यहाँ तो ज़्यादा डिस्कशन होते नहीं, लेकिन जहाँ भी विदेशों के अंदर में जो भी सेमिनार्स वगैरह या जो भी टॉक्स वगैरह पे मैं जाता हूँ, न्यूक्लियर इश्यूज़ के ऊपर में, न्यूक्लियर उसके बारे में मैं उस, हम उस क्षेत्र के अंदर में विवेकानंद फाउंडेशन में ज़्यादा काम इंटरनेशनल लेवल पर कर रहे हैं, ज़्यादा उसका स्वीप जो है स्वैथ एक इंडिया की इंटरनेशनल रिलेशंस और इंडिया की इंटरनेशनल सिक्योरिटी एंड डोमेस्टिक सिक्योरिटी के बारे में। लेकिन ये एक दर्द का विषय है कि इस देश के अंदर में कोई इस तरह की उत्तेजना लोगों के अंदर, हमने तो सोचा था लोग ओवरनाइट जब सोचेंगे और देखेंगे कि ये फैक्ट्स हैं तो शायद उनके अंदर में एक वो होगा, और शहरों के अंदर में या छोटी छोटी बातों के ऊपर में इतने बड़े जुलूस निकल जाते हैं, यहाँ तो कुछ नहीं होता। चलिए
Thank you very much. The floor is to our Secretary of Vidarbha Management Association, Mr. Mustafa Mahmood.
Good evening, friends. Sometime back, I read a quote of Nelson Mandela on leadership. It goes like this. It is better to lead from behind and put others in front, especially when you celebrate victory. You take the front line when there is danger. Friends, Mr. Ajit Doval has shown this leadership quality many times during his tenure, where he has stayed with the top brass militants at their hideouts as an undercover agent for days together or as posing as a rickshaw puller. He has led his team right from the front lines in hard times. If one searches, goes to the internet and does a Google search, he can read such numerous stories about his leadership. Friends, he is a true leader. Sir, it has been a great privilege for us that you were able to spare some time from your busy schedule and come to this event. As a gesture of appreciation, I request our project director, Mr. Anand Dhopte, who has single-handedly handled the whole event, to present a memento as a gesture of love and appreciation on behalf of Vidarbha Management Association. Planning such a big event without the help of sponsors and associate partners is very difficult. This event would not have been possible without that. Ajit Doval, sir, I request you to please hand over a bouquet to our sponsors and associate partners. I request Mr. Vishal Agrawal from Plasto, our presenting partner, to come forward. From Plasto, I would also like to call Mr. Nilesh Agrawal to come forward, if he could come forward. I request Mr. Amit Dani from Think Wealth Managers, our co-sponsors, to come forward. I request Chairman Mr. Swapnil Agrawal of Nagpur branch of Chartered Accountants, Partners in Building Nation, our associate partners, to come forward. Next, I would request our Vice President, Mr. Praful Baid, to hand over the bouquet to Mr. Vasan Kinkar, Sanchalak of Vivekananda Kendra, Nagpur, our associate partners, to come forward. Without the help of Vivekananda Kendra, Nagpur, it would not have been possible to invite Mr. Ajitji Doval to Nagpur. So, I think we should all give a big clap for that. Thanks a lot, sir. Dear guests, at VMA, we regularly meet every Sunday at 10:30 a.m. to discuss various business management topics and to update our knowledge. We believe in experiential learning from experiences of other members. Please do consider joining our association. Membership forms and are available outside at the counter. You can also get updates about Vidarbha Management Association regularly from our website vmanagpur.org and our Facebook page. Lastly, on behalf of Vidarbha Management Association, I would like to thank all members and guests who have spared their valuable time for attending this event. Thanks a lot for coming. Thank you.